Oh, there is.
The Sayula National Forest has been working with the Oregon Silverspot butterfly for about 40 years. It was listed in 1980. And back then, pretty much all we knew about it was that it was dependent on the early blue violet for its host plant. The caterpillars can only eat early blue violets. And that early blue violets were being overtaken by invasive grasses. They were being topped over, shaded out, dying off. So our entire program consisted of trying to cut back those non-native grasses and improve habitat for the Viola dunca, or the early blue violet. Unfortunately, despite all kinds of efforts for years and years and years, the overall population trend kept decreasing until the point where of the five populations that were around when it was listed in 1980, we only had one population left on Mount Hebo that was able to sustain itself without help from us. That was a pretty scary moment for us when we realized that. And one of the big things that we realized was that everything we knew about the silver spot was based on when it's an adult. And we could only study the adults for a few weeks every summer. And their needs when they're an adult are way different than their needs from when they're a caterpillar. And so to me, I felt like the only way to try to turn around this downward trend was to understand what was impacting the butterfly during 80% of its life when it's a caterpillar. The problem was that nobody had ever found a caterpillar in the wild, and we didn't know anything about what they needed in the wild. Fortunately for me, I was working with a group of detection dogs on another very rare species. And when I was out in the field working with them, I just started talking with them. They're brilliant biologists in addition to being dog handlers. And we sort of just talked through the problems. Could we find caterpillars in the wild using detection dogs? And their answer was, as long as we have training material, we can find them. Once we were finally able to train them on live caterpillars from the zoo program, we were able to cover such a large area, and the dogs would indicate, and they were able to very quickly, in just a few days, tell us that yes, there are caterpillars emerging from diapause, they are surviving, and they're well distributed across the landscape, which again, at that point, we had no idea any of those answers. In figuring out that there were a lot of answers to be had if we could study animals in the wild, I started reaching out to research scientists like Cheryl Schultz at the Washington State University, Michelle Zwarches with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and Rich Van Buskirk from Pacific University. As a kind of group, we would go back to all of the questions that we had had over the years, and we tried to get it down to, if we're going to affect survival of silver spot, what do we need answers to? So we picked a few questions.
There has been a lot of work out at these sites, at the Forest Service sites, the state park sites, and others, where there's been a lot of management on the ground for the last 20 or 30 years or more, at the same time as they have been bringing butterflies out from the zoos, so doing captive rearing programs. Very limited monitoring had been done. And so we knew that there was management happening, and we knew there was captive rearing going on, but we didn't know what the effectiveness is. We didn't know, like, is it working?
Cheryl, I think that's your 160 over there.
So we reached out to Dr. Erica Henry. Erica is an amazing butterfly ecologist. She's really one of the leading butterfly ecologists working with rare butterflies. She has incredible experience, diligence, creativity, and talent, and was the perfect person to really lead this study in the field.
What we did is we went in and clipped the grasses carefully and removed all the thatch around the violets in an area that we could monitor. So we put in enclosures that are 1.5 meters by 1.5 meters. So that's about 5 feet by 5 feet. I like to think of them as baby play gyms, because when I first saw the picture, it made me think of all the baby play gyms. So it's our silver spot baby play gyms. In a couple different places, we had plots that were clipped, plots that were not clipped. And then we also put in loggers to measure temperature and humidity, and put the caterpillars in, put the enclosures over them, and then waited to see how many butterflies would come out. And those are just about done coming out. When we started, there was all these questions like, would any butterflies come out? Would they crawl under? Would predators like bite through the webbing? Would bears get them? Because bears have now gotten some into some of the pupil enclosures. All kinds of things. Like, we just didn't know. We have seen lots and lots of butterflies come out of them. Erica has been pulling them out daily, and she has started to pull some cursory analyses. It looks like around twice as many butterflies are coming out of the areas that are clipped versus areas that aren't. And we think that makes a lot of sense because we know from studies that were done on larval biology that when caterpillars are crawling around the ground, they'll finish eating a violet and then they've got to find their next violet plant. And if it's bare ground, they can crawl around and they kind of wander for a while, but they find more violets. But if there's a ton of thatch, just kind of like going through a maze, they're up and down and up and down and around and over, and they can crawl a long time, but it's much harder to crawl through, you know, 10 inches of thick thatch than it is to crawl over bare ground and find what you're looking for. Because even if you don't find it immediately, you go, oh, I just bit the wrong thing. I'm going to go find something else. You know, that's really informal. We haven't formally analyzed the data, but the gestalt is we're getting higher survivorship in the plots that have been clipped, which is, you know, that's good. It's good information because it helps us think about what's the effect of potential management, how do we manage habitat in the future. That also couples with other pieces of interest, which is these butterflies have been put in the field for years from this captive rearing program, but because they've never been marked, we don't know what they're doing. We don't know whether they survive. We don't know where they go. We don't know if they completely disperse off site and never come back again. We just don't know what the effect of putting all these individuals is in terms of, does it actually help our wild populations? So this summer's project is really two pieces. One piece is funded by the Forest Service, which is to look at the effectiveness of habitat management on the ability of caterpillars to grow and survive in these habitats. And the second part, funded by U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, is to look at the adult dispersal and look at where do the captive individuals go, meaning not captive, but raised in the zoo and then released, versus where, what are the wild ones doing? How much are they flying around between all these different pieces of habitats? A very common way in butterfly ecology to estimate population size is through mark recapture methods. And basically the idea is every day you go out and you mark every butterfly you see that's unmarked, and you identify the mark, so in this case the silver or the blue glitter on the wings, to know that it's been marked. So by knowing the relative proportion of marked versus unmarked each day throughout the season, you can statistically estimate both how many butterflies are out within the entire population over the season. You can also find out how long individuals are living, so adult survival.
At first, I was playing around with how I wanted to mark them. So this one actually has silver gel pen on the underside of the wing too, but I wasn't certain if that would last long enough. And so that's why we switched to the Sharpie, because I've done mark recapture with Sharpies before and knew that that would last. And then when you let them go, you just open your fingers and they flap around and they pretend like you killed them. And then they fly away just fine. Every time we see a butterfly, we take a GPS point and record the behavior. That one was just basking in the grass. Whether it's a new capture or recapture, if we catch females right now, we're noting whether they're like freshly emerged or old and tattered. Whether we use the net to reset a butterfly, and if they're nectaring, what species of flower they're nectaring on. And then we take a picture of the vegetation around where we saw the butterfly so we can do some vegetation analyses later.
in order to do any sort of work with the species itself, you do have to get permitted through the Fish and Wildlife Service. So there's a pretty large process where you submit your project plan and the Fish and Wildlife Service determines whether or not your project aligns with the recovery of the species and will start to answer some of those really important questions to lead towards recovery of the species. And if it does, then the second step is Fish and Wildlife Service determining the potential impact by doing this study that you're going to have on the species, and that's both in a negative and a positive light. So that's when I came into the picture, and that's when my office and Michelle's war chest with the Newport Field Office came in. The wonderful thing is the type of research that was being asked to be done, that can answer so many questions about the life history of a butterfly, and they're not really questions that we have thoroughly explored in the past. And every single answer will make giant steps towards recovery of the species.
The other piece that we want to understand is their dispersal behavior. So we want to know, you know, is a butterfly that comes out here found somewhere else? How much is it traveling on a daily basis? These guys live a long time, on a weekly basis. And we're finding out a lot. We're seeing marked individuals that are moving between parts of this meadow system within a day.
192. We just marked this butterfly.
And sometimes finding them weeks later, which is super exciting.
Oh my gosh! It's number 16 again. It's the oldest female we marked.
Most of my work has been with blue butterflies that live a week to 10 days maybe. So the fact that we're seeing individuals that were marked on like July 5th and now it's August 19th is really pretty impressive.
This species is doing things that I don't see a lot of species doing personally, and I think that's just so neat.
There's even stuff about adults that we thought we knew just about everything about that we're discovering for the first time. And by having people out in the field and taking such a hard look at this stuff, other things started popping into, you know, our awareness.
I mean, the biggest surprise was that butterflies came out. The first butterfly was seen on June 25th, which was really early. And we marked probably 130 wild butterflies-ish in the next 3 weeks or so. And only maybe a handful of them were females. But then we just like did not see them. We did not resight any of them. Every butterfly we caught and marked was a male. And we were like, what is happening? You can't have a population with no females. And then really just like a week and a half ago, maybe. So like August 5th or so, we started catching females. And we started resighting females that we had marked, you know, like number 16 and 17 were the first two females that I marked on July 5th. No sign of females. And then those first few days with females, we resighted both of those butterflies. So females have merged here early, and they either left the site or I feel like they had to have left the site. So now I have new questions about like, where do they go? If they're going to some interior meadows, like there have to be flowers to keep them alive for a month, if they're gonna live for a month and then come back here and lay eggs. But then there's also fresh individuals emerging. It's like multiple reproductive strategies. You know, if there are females going somewhere to interior meadows, then knowing where those are is really important for population persistence, because we have to have resources in the landscape to keep the females alive before they lay eggs. The other thing is that if butterflies are emerging earlier because it's getting warmer, but they're still laying eggs at the same time, that like stretches out the amount of time that they have to stay alive. And if both of those things aren't shifting in the same way in a warmer year, then that is really interesting and could have some sort of unique climate change impacts for population persistence too. So now all my text messages to Cheryl were like, I have new questions. I have so many questions.
When we started this summer, when everyone involved, all of these wonderful partners started the summer of, you know, investigating these two big questions, everyone had in their minds that this is called a pilot year. So it's a year where you're doing something really different from what you've done in the past, and you have no clue if it's going to be successful or not. And we clearly have seen a ton of success in both step one and step two of this multi-year, multi-level project. And I think that's a perfect segue into just continuing to expand, because the pilot year ended up actually being a true sample year for us, which means we have great data for one of these locations that, you know, a metapopulation is at. So the hopes and the dreams are to expand that project in future years to all of our other locations where the silver spot is currently found or can be found or has been found in the past, to start to make that bigger picture of what's going on in each of these habitats. Is it different? Is it the same? Does it allow for maybe large weather events? If climate change is directly impacting certain locations, are there other locations that we can work on that, you know, we can develop into a habitat for them to use in the future? And all sorts of great questions like that.
This is a great example of different agencies working together and really coming together as partnerships, saying we need to understand more about the biology and its habitat in order to really design effective conservation.
It's been a pretty exciting summer, and we're really looking forward to gathering up everything that we've observed, everything that we've learned, and discussing some next steps and what answers we need a little bit more depth on, and where we can go from here, and what changes we might make to management on the Sayusla that we can then see if that's going to help turn this around for the silver spot.